Rolls-Royce is well known for its bespoke products. There are countless occasions on which the company's customers have used its products as a canvas to build what they want to. And Rolls-Royce has always obliged to these demands. We have countless Maharajas in India itself taking advantage of this. So yes, coach building is in its genes, one can say. There are clear standouts. The 4050 HP Phantom 1 Brougham Deville in 1926. The Phantom 2 Continental Drophead Coupe in 1934. The Phantom 6 Limousine in 1972. And very recently in 2017, the Rolls-Royce Sweptail. All these gave momentum to the coach building movement. But when a customer comes along and asks, "Show me something that I have never seen before." Well, the result looks something like this. At nearly 5,800 millimeters long, the Rolls-Royce boat tail features the new treatment of Rolls-Royce's iconic Pantheon grille and lights. The grille becomes an integral part of the front end, not an applique. The nautical references are very suggestive. The wraparound windscreen recalls the visor on motor launches, while the gentle rearward lean of the A-pillar, the large crisp volumes at the front and the tapered rear create a gesture that recalls a motor launch rising out of water under power. Indeed, it is at the rear where the nautical references become more apparent. The aft deck, a modern interpretation of the wooden rear decks of historical boat tails, incorporates large swathes of wood. However, what catches your eye is the boat tail's unconventional fixed canopy roof. The sweeping roof line concludes in delicate structural elements that touch down on the rear. Of course, if inclement weather is encountered while the roof is removed, a temporary tonneau is stored so that it can provide shelter. A telescopic movement opens this beautiful and whimsical canopy inversely. Five electronic control units were created for the rear of the car alone, a process that required a completely redesigned, dedicated wiring harness, which was the product of 9 months of intensive research and development. Only then was it possible for the deck lids to open to an appropriate 67 degree angle. The exclusivity continues on the inside. The interior leather reflects the bonnet's color tone transition, with the front seats swathed in the darker blue hue. A double refrigerator has been developed on request, and care was taken to ensure that the cradles were created to store a specific bottle size. It's absolutely a one-off car that makes it even more exclusive. It's a fully homologated, road-legal motor car, mind you. And we are sure that this one, like all other Rolls-Royces, will make heads turn.
The northeastern part of India is a gem. Hidden away from the regular touristic crowd, all seven states offer raw, scenic beauty beyond imagination. The famous American poet Maya Angelou rightly said, life is not measured by the number of breaths we take, but by the moments that take our breath away. And the state of Arunachal Pradesh is filled with such pristine scenic beauty, which not only takes your breath away, but fills your lungs with clean, crisp mountain air at the same time. Few things in life can be as invigorating. We were invited for the first ever 2021 Trans Arunachal Drive, organized by the Ministry of Tourism Arunachal Pradesh in partnership with Mahindra Adventure and JK Tire. And it was a drive that added wonderful color, beautiful new memories and years to our lives. We were given the key to a Mahindra Thar, a diesel automatic, and that proved to be our second home for the next few days. Only because we spent a lot of time driving the SUV. The 2021 Trans Arunachal Drive had a convoy of close to 25 cars. The drive was flagged off by Chief Minister of Arunachal Pradesh, Pema Khandu, from the Golden Pagoda, a Burmese-style Buddhist temple in Namsai district. The architecture is slightly different from other Buddhist temples that you would normally see in India. The first destination in our itinerary was the Pangsau Pass. It lies in the Patkai Hills on the border of Myanmar and Arunachal. Pangsau is actually a small village on the Burmese side of the border. The drive up to Pangsau Pass was lovely, and the roads snaked through dense foliage. Situated at an altitude of 3,727 feet, the Pangsau Pass used to be an old trade route between tribes of eastern India and Myanmar in the old days, and the pass continues to be open even today. So right now we are here at Pangsau Pass, and the nondescript huts that you see behind me, that is actually Myanmar. So yes, we are right now at the India-Myanmar border, and Pangsau Pass was called Hell's Gate in World War II around 1944-1942. Because this area saw some of the bloodiest battles in World War II. So that's a bit of history info right for you. Once a week, a market gathering or a haat is organized at the border, and people from either side come together to trade in spices, clothes, jewelry and other merchandise. In fact, the border is open, so we did actually step over to the other side and ticked off a new country from a bucket list. Small pleasures, you see. After a session of photography, we headed back to the hotel for a night of local dinner and drinks. Saw us driving to Haulyang, and we started off with a lovely road to begin with. And then, in the proverbial blink of an eye, the tarmac gave way to an excuse of a dirt road. As Mahindra always says, Thar hates tar. Our diesel automatic Thar couldn't give two hoots about the roads turning from bad to non-existent. It plowed through the very worst with consummate ease, and we didn't even have to make an effort to guide it over mud, slush, rocks and whatnot. As the road got tougher, the scenery got prettier. Lush green hills, warm friendly faces of the locals, and the convoy snaking up switchbacks one after the other painted a rather pretty picture. The drive was long but scenic to say the least, and it turned dark before we reached our camping spot for the night. We camped right next to Lohit River with the tents pitched right on the banks. next morning was one of those where we had a pleasant surprise in store for us. It was misty, and since we had a late start to the day, we went to the riverbed and got some fantastic photographs of the Mahindra Thar and the campsite as well. Right now, we are in this beautiful village called Hayuliang in eastern Arunachal. And it couldn't get much more picture perfect than this. You have a fast flowing alpine river behind me, lush green hills, and the overall setting is so beautiful. And the good news was that we camped for the night right beside the river. It was a beautiful, pristine setting to say the least. Post shenanigans, we packed up and made our way to Kaho in Anjor district, a small settlement on the Indochina border. The drive to Kaho again was one of those moments which took your breath away.
So this is the third day of the first ever Trans Arunachal Drive experience, and right now we are here at Kaho village. What's so special about this village is that this is the easternmost village in India. Yes, literally next to the China border. In fact, we'll show you glimpses of the China border itself. We are walking up till there. We have close to 25 cars in the convoy, all beautifully stickered Scorpios and the new generation Thars. We have been driving the Thar and it's been a wonderful experience. The drive from Hauliang to Kaho has been phenomenal to say the least. I mean, the mountains here are below the snow line, therefore they are lush green. We also got a bit of rain as well. And finally, all the peaks have fogged up and it presents a beautiful, beautiful scenery.
Our stay in Bomjheel was organized at a nature resort, and as soon as we entered, we were welcomed with yet another mesmerizing dance performance. The women folk from the Trans Arunachal Drive convoy couldn't help but join in and dance with them as well. The state of Arunachal Pradesh and its people offered us a beautiful experience, one that we would cherish for the rest of our lives. And for those who are looking to travel, do keep Arunachal Pradesh and its neighboring states in mind. The Northeast is exceedingly beautiful, way beyond you could ever imagine, and a trip there will change your life for sure. The prevailing COVID-19 situation has kept us homebound,
and the cars are again parked for a long while. Thanks to the second wave of this deadly virus that has gripped India. Here's a list of few car accessories that you must have handy in these testing times. First up is the car sanitization kit that essentially contains an alcohol-based hand sanitizer, a disinfectant, a pair of gloves, and few masks. While it's pretty much obvious why you need the hand sanitizer and mask, the disinfectant can be regularly used on frequent touch points of your car, like door handles, wing mirrors, grab handles on the inside, steering wheel, gear knob, handbrake lever, switches, and the touchscreen infotainment system, among others. Just a word of caution, make sure to turn off the air conditioner of your vehicle before spraying the disinfectant, as it's hazardous. While earlier air purifiers were developed to tackle the pollution levels in regions like Delhi NCR or even Mumbai, among others, where the air quality index is poor. Now, some of these air purifiers that are FDA certified also have the capability to moderate the risk of virus spread inside a vehicle. While standard purifiers use fan and filter systems to trap large particles circulating through the air, these devices rely on a special UVA light to break down the pollutants on a molecular level. A chemical reaction caused by the light destroys the particles once internal filters trap them. And what comes out is disinfected air. Most of us are homebound due to the current situation and we step out only when absolutely necessary. Meanwhile, our cars remain parked and the best way to avoid people frequently touching our cars is to cover them, thereby reducing the risk of virus spread through it. Now, it's not advisable to keep the handbrakes of your car engaged if it's been parked for a long while. The brake wire tends to block and your wheel movement won't be as free when you resume driving. While you're advised to engage the first gear while parked, the wheel lock clamp will just give that extra layer of safety, ensuring your car doesn't roll forward or the other way, along with reducing the risk of theft. Tires tend to lose pressure if the car's been stationary for too long. Electric air pumps are easily available online and you just need to plug it into the 12-volt socket of your car, set pressure limit and attach it to the tire valve. Finding a puncture repair shop at this point of time is a nightmare, and if you've had one, it's better to manage it all by yourself. Majority of the cars these days run on tubeless tires and puncture repair kit is easily available online. In many cases, you don't even need to unbolt the wheels to repair them. Many of us could be in a situation where the battery runs out of power if the vehicle is parked for a long time. While it's advisable to start the engine of your car at least once a week and keep it running for 15 minutes, it's better to have jump cables handy just in case.